fudge you.
That's a nice curve, the swiggly on
looks
the...
like a heartbeat.
Mike, please put those hands... Stop.
It's begun.
It's begun.
That was your sinking, Jesse. You're welcome.
Sinking from what?
You know that.
Sinking like the ship we're on.
Is it the friendship?
Yes.
Welcome to Let's Talk in the Corner, everyone. This is Jesse.
Mike! I wanted to go second this time.
And Joey. Mike's apparently in a mood.
In a mood?
And it's this time of the month.
Yeah, let's go with that.
Should I run? Cry? Hide? Which
no, thing? You stay here as a buffer between me and him.
Okay. Oh, the giggles are strong tonight. Oh, boy.
So,
how easily start out? Gosh, dang it. How easily
start? We've broken, Jesse!
Stop! You mustn't stop. You mustn't break Jesse. You'll need him for editing.
Future Jesse will be fine. We can break past Jesse all we want.
You get 64 experience.
Hey! You're a weak level of creature. It's like level 2.
No, it's somewhere between 1 and 2. Yeah. 2s are like in the hundreds.
Yeah.
They're like 150 to 200-ish.
Yeah, but
depends on the game.
Depends on the monster.
Depends on the game and the monster. Are we just going to go through the schematics of XP between
creatures? Yeah, just determine like what game Jesse is a creature in.
Yeah. Oh,
God. The RPG abomination.
That's something for the comments sections to go over. That's where we can start a discussion.
He's the level 1 boss.
I can live with this.
The tutorial
boss. The tutorial boss. So, as I was trying to say, we start the show, we usually talk about what we've been up to, games we've been playing, so who wants to go first?
Why don't you?
Yes, all right. I don't know why I pounded myself in the chest in an agreement.
13 plus all.
I love doing that now. Whenever I heal myself in D&D, I've just started going 13 and slapped myself on the chest.
And the 13 is like, or like, the number value you...
The number value that you heal yourself, and your character just goes like 14 and slap himself.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, anyway, go ahead.
So, thank you for that. So, for me, I am, you know, it's getting around to the finals, so I have not done too much on gaming, but I have, very recently, I've gotten gotten two VR games. The first one was a very impulse buy, because Dungeons & Dragons had released a VR chess game. And I mostly kind of thought, oh, it's kind of cool. It's in the D&D world, and the setting and the pieces are actual D&D characters. Even though I'm not a big chess player, I don't mind dabbling into it. So it was just very entertaining just to be in the end of the yawning portal playing chess with, like, animated miniatures.
It fulfilled his wizard's chest.
Yes.
His wizard's chest role.
Yeah,
what game is that called?
I remember it's from the when I watched the Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone movie.
Well, no, I meant the game. What is it called?
Oh, it's called Dungeon Chess.
Okay.
So anyway, so it, as Joe was kind of saying, it's like, I remember when I watched the scene of them playing wizard chess, I kind of always wanted to play it. So it only took like an over $1,000 laptop with $800 worth of equipment of VR to make that dream happen. And
it's like, yay, over $1,000 worth of equipment, and I can play chess.
Yes!
Question is, was it worth it?
Well...
I would say, with how much you've been talking about it.
Yep. So, and the other game I've been playing that was that I got for free because I have the motion controllers. And it's called Robo Recall. And basically the story is, it's very similar to the movie of iRobot. Basically, you're living in this future, robots have become, it is commonplace, like living amongst humans, and then something is going awry, they're going crazy. You're an agent for the people that are producing robots, and you're just a recall agent. And basically, you're going around, basically destroying the robots they have, that are going malfunction. And I only played about an hour in, but you always have pistols equipped to your waist at all times. So when you're out of ammo, you just throw the pistols and you just pull out new ones. Or if you reach back behind your shoulder, you pull out three barrel rotating shotguns. And they're during battles, you can throw the guns at enemies. They take damage or kill them. If you're close enough, you can just take a hold of a robot because they have like the design of the robots have like a little handle in front of them. So you can just grab their handle, then use your other hand to grab the head or grab the arm and just tear it off them. Or if they fire a bullet, you can catch and throw back. Same thing with rockets. So it's just pure mayhem, and I just love it. Is the comedy?
So it's essentially testosterone and adrenaline. The game.
Yeah, but it's very comical because at one point I was so focused in the robots behind me, eventually I got shot. From behind, and I hear a robot, "I am behind the enemy!" And I'm like, "Fudge you!" And I just blast him. So it's like, and even one of the phrases I heard, it's like, remember our slogan, you work for us now. Just like, that's from a good
slogan.
Yeah. Like, from this company, so I've only dabbled in a little bit, but I do plan on playing more, and again, not much in gaming other than I've been trying to beat Fire Emblem Fates, because the next Fire Emblem's going to be coming out next month, and
I still need to play Fates.
Yeah, Fates, I'm about halfway through. I'm currently going through I'm not doing Birthright or Conquest yet. I'm just doing a Revelation, which is basically the true story. And I'm basically just playing through that. And I'm about halfway through and been really enjoying it. Just mostly been playing during breaks at work and school. In terms of gaming wise, that's about it. Just school spent, final projects are taking a lot of my time. I'm currently working on an animation from episode 2 of Crystal Shards. It's a part of there's one spot of grass go to it. Still one of my favorite moments in our series. I've really been wanting to animate that. I've done a comic drawing, now I'm animating it. So that's it for me. Who's next?
Yeah, sorry everyone who was part of his Twitch stream, he completely forgot about you. Hi, Jesse.
Thanks. Thanks for having my back, best friend.
You're welcome.
You're a true pal.
As I said, sinking ship.
Yes, I streamed XCOM 2 on last Tuesday in terms of this recording. Thank you. Did you just give a toast to yourself?
Yes, I did. And future self pops in to toast with me.
We'll get to that later. That's a good story. And speaking of XCOM, since you're the future, Jesse, I was referring to, I don't have to kill you.
Wonderful.
And now that you brought that up, Mike, what have you been up to?
Oddly enough, not a ton of games. What I've mostly been doing is getting my quest together that I'm going to be running with the group that we're doing for the new D&D guys or people. Mostly girls, actually. And I've been preparing my victims.
Yes, so, by making them roll their stats wrong.
But, hey, they have a valid point value. Some are a little higher and loud.
That's not how you make them roll.
Can you please explain?
I know I did it wrong.
Can you explain to the audience what you're talking about?
So in D&D, when you create a character, there are a couple of ways to choose your stats, which are basically, strength, dexterity, constitution, wisdom, intelligence, and charisma. Those are your 6 stats. Now, there are a couple of ways to join them. There are some default values you can choose from and place them in, their valid slots. there are, you can do a point buy value in which you basically have 75 points that you distribute amongst, you know, the various slots, or you can roll. Now, when you roll, you're supposed to roll either 3d6 and take that value, or 4d6 and add in the top, the three highest dice. That basically gives you one, like, blank dice that gives you an extra chance of getting higher stats. And then basically aligning the stats that way. What Mike did...
What I did is I had them roll a d20 for each stat, and then I adjusted it later so that it matched the point buy value. And yes, no, it's not the right way to do it, I know, but they have the same amount of points that you would with the point buy value, and it still matches generally what they rolled. And they have some high rolls, and they have some really, really low rolls, which is going to make it interesting.
One intelligence means they can't speak.
They don't. No one has a one intelligence.
Anymore.
No, they still don't. Oh, yeah, so yeah, I bumped that up to a three intelligence.
They still can't speak! Minimum to speak, and minimum to be able to fluently speak a language is, I think, 8 or 7.
It's,
do you know?
Marvelous.
No, it's not, because we never had stats that low to go
no!
over.
No! Oh. No one does!
Oh, it's marvelous.
You, okay, if these were veteran players, I wouldn't give you so much crap about this, but these are new players!
Yes, they are.
You don't initiate them into D&D with wrong fucking stats!
What if it has a -3 on intelligence? It's marvelous.
See, you're having fun with it.
I'm having hell of fun with it.
His character,
and you know who you are, too.
His character literally can't talk.
Her character, and I know. She will anyway.
But if they, then how, like, for me, it's like, I would hate to have a character can't talk.
They
and
say,
like,
ugh.
That, that could be gross.
They have to roll for intelligence to say sentence.
What the hell? Not for a first timer.
I'm not making him do that.
Yeah, that's just, that's the only part where we're concerned. Like, once we heard word of this, like, these are new players. We're trying to introduce them to this, and they are being heavily penalized at the first ever.
How dare you start D&D? Have the worst intelligence. My summoned falcon has higher intelligence than that character. It is a bird!
They're worse than being a bird brain. Wonderful.
What the hell?
Oh, God, let me pull
them up.
Where'd
you find these people?
Oh,
I would be like an NPC, be like, where'd you find them? I didn't know you people existed.
There it is. So, I have Terra pulled up here. Let's see here. Strength score of 11. Dexterity of a 19. Constitution of a 17. Intelligence of a 4. Wisdom of 13. And Charisma of 11. Once again, high stats and low stats. Really, really low stats.
But don't get me wrong. The dexterity. This is going to be the dumbest. Like, this ranger is going to be an amazing shot. Like, never miss. But it's just like...
Oh my god.
The next one, Udra. I'm not pronouncing the last name. Strength of 16, dexterity of 10, constitution of 13, intelligence of 10, wisdom of 10, charisma of 16. That's not bad.
No, that's about normal, actually.
Right, then that's a paladin.
Yeah, that's
and
pretty,
then the other one, Giffrey. Because I'm not pronouncing it the other way, you know who you are. Strength of 20.
It's literally spelled Giffrey.
Yes.
Yes, but it's based on the whole GIF thing. Every character in that world is going to call them Giffrey, because I disagree. It's a GIF, not a GIF.
It was originally by the creators.
I don't give a shit.
Of
I call
the format. It's called a GIF.
All my life, it's been a GIF, goddammit. And it's going to
stay
that
way. And you've been wrong
way.
All your life.
And I don't give a shit anymore.
All aboard the friendship. We're all friends here together.
Anyway, so on this character, strength of 20, that was a good roll, dexterity of an 8, a constitution of 16, intelligence of 15, wisdom of a 6, minus 2, and a charisma of a 10.
Those are terrible!
Yes, they are!
Oh my god, I feel
but
so...
The strength, oh my god, I mean, the attack, okay. Plus 7 on level 1...
Go back to it. Go back to the other. This thing has the grace and wisdom of a rodent.
It's a rogue.
So it's just like...
It's a little lacking in common.
It's a rogue that punches things.
It's a rogue that punches things. Wait, the rogue has the minus stat in dexterity?
Are you retarded?
He rolled bad.
I mean, oh my god. If it were a barbarian, fine. If it were even just a regular, like, fighter, fine.
Their armor... we can,
but it's a rogue!
So to be fair, we can re-roll these properly if anybody wants to.
Say but, yes!
No bias here at all.
What I didn't realize is that the leather armor's stat is based on dexterity.
Yes! Rogues! Rogues entirely are based on dexterity!
You need to change that. Oh, if you hilarious. Want this character to live...
has an armor class of 10. A slight breeze will. Has an initiative of minus 1.
This is like the opposite of rogue. This is like a, you might as well be a commoner.
I'm turning into a squeaky toy.
You're becoming the human equivalent of Bunny Boo.
That's wonderful.
I'm glad you're having a blast, man. I'm going to scream it. This is so wrong.
I'm going to love how they're going to listen to this. They're going to be like, what the fuck, man?
We trusted you.
I never said I was good at D&D. I just have some experience in it.
You're going to be the dungeon
master. Oh. Watch, he's gonna have all his, like, the monsters have regular stats.
They do have regular stats, actually.
Oh, god sweet damn it.
Oh, sweet Moses. Oh, god.
Why didn't you give the rogue the strength?
Don't worry about it.
He's just a mad DM. Be grateful you're not a player in this party.
No kidding.
So
of course, I can create my own character, so marvelous. I'd come and derail his little shit.
Oh, I imagine
you multi-class hardcore to keep the party alive.
No kidding. I'd need, like, Faldor to come into his quest.
I'm a sorcerer, wizard, cleric.
So, Jesse, about that offer about joining?
If I do, I'm bringing in... Oh, God.
Bring Violet. She's actually pretty decent.
I assume all level ones.
Yeah, he wants to bring in a level one, which it is. That's never played.
Yeah, so I'm, like I said, I'm splitting a couple of those, but we'll see you later. So other than going mad with D&D stats, any games of the video variety you've been playing?
Just mental games with people.
Oh, jeez.
And succeeding.
Hey, we just got a good laugh out of it.
Are you just saying, as long as we laugh about it, it's all good?
Pretty much.
This possible massacre to the party. And we're laughing about it.
Possible massacre? But the only reason... Well, okay. So two of them have good chances of keeping it survively. But if the rogue player plays his character as a rogue, they will die. That is more of a glass cannon than our, like, random characters that we created.
Yeah. To be fair, I've survived on worse. We've all seen Lob's stats.
Lob is smarter than that!
And your stats, and here's the thing, your stats on Lob are for intelligence, wisdom, and charisma. Not dex!
I know.
You got good dex and strength. You can barely talk to people, but that's okay.
No, Lob can talk fantastically to people. I think we can all...
Define it fantastically. I'm surprised. Can Lob can't even say fantastically.
If I try... It takes a couple tries.
I was not kidding when I said that my summoned bird, my familiar, it's just a regular fucking hawk, is smarter than your character.
That's marvelous.
And if it knows English, I'm going to say my bird can speak, because fuck the logic there.
Your bird can communicate psychically to you.
to me because I summoned it.
And to anything else that you wish.
No, that's me doing it. I know.
But either
way. Channel magic
to
the damn
So bird. This is a good time for your future self to come in.
Stop!
I wasn't home when he popped in last time. He missed the time.
Oh. So just wanted, we,
okay, well,
that's a transition to what we...
No, got. I haven't actually gone yet.
And I actually haven't finished, because we got laughing on that so hard.
My apologies, Joe.
The only actual game that I've been playing recently besides screwing with people is MechWarrior, which I kind of talk about every time, and I have started doing some recording.
People are going to start thinking that's the only game you play.
Okay, I've been playing Ark some. Oh, no, that was in the last video.
Some.
I've been watching a lot of anime, to be quite honest.
Yeah, we all get in those times.
Anyway, now I'm done.
All right, please go ahead, Joe. I apologize for missing you.
All right, so mostly game-wise, not too much. Honestly, probably no more Breath of the Wild. I recorded a bit of that, and I'm actually going to just turn it into a Let's Play and just put that on the channel. D&D-wise, I actually haven't really started on getting the characters all together. I started with trying to get a hold of Bitsy, and then every time, it's either I kept getting distracted, or Bitsy was. Or, you know, I'm busy all day and not able to talk to her. So, this weekend, I'm gonna get in contact with her to make her damn character.
Hopefully
but
better than I did.
But for Bitsy, I know she's a big music nerd. It's like one of those part of me, it's like, if she's not a bard, I swear.
That's up to her. I'm going to explain to her all the classes and races, and she can decide.
I know, but
if
she wants me personally.
If she wants to be a halfling barbarian, I'm all for it.
Just that little part of me just wants to cheer for that. Just this. But again, it's just, that's just me.
So. Other than that, in D&D-wise, I've decided on a new weapon that I want to forge. On Imgur, Mike here found a picture that basically pointed out the fact that in order to get enough iron to make a longsword, you would need to collect all the blood out of 359 people. And so, I saw that, and I decided I want to make a D&D character that does this.
Yeah, so we got in a long discussion of how we'd be able to pull this off and all
so,
this.
To put that in perspective, that is 458.75
gallons.
Oh my god. He's going to have a character that has to carry around that much blood.
I need a bag of holding.
Yeah, that's what we said. A bag of holding is required for this guy.
And then he has to find somebody that is willing to magically or otherwise separate the iron
from the blood. That I've collected over the course of like a year.
But that blood's going to be nasty at that point. Gonna be all coagulated and congealed and
oh, fun.
So
obviously evil character.
Yes, going to be definitely a evil character. At best chaotic neutral. At best chaotic neutral, leaning towards evil. But let me think. There hasn't been too much else, really, that I've been up to. Work. Sleep.
Eat.
Strangle
Jesse.
I'm behind on my quota that week. Let's fix this.
Why are you joining in here, Mike?
He wants in on the fun.
Yeah.
Friendship is magic. Yay!
Oh, God.
Am I the source of magic now?
Yes, and we have to strangle you.
Shake it out.
Oh, God, I hate to be a vessel of magic now.
Yeah, you know, it's like not like the genie rub, you know. It's strangle and shake.
Oh, God.
We need magic, damn it!
It's okay, Jesse.
We're back on the golf clap. Yes. Golf clap.
Golf clap on the face.
I love when you look back on the audio. There's like, bah, 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 bah. It's picking up the maps.
Wait, is it? Not really.
Well, you're doing it at the top of the head.
Hold on.
That's a hardest part of the head.
There we go. Whack, whack, whack. Really violent there.
I know I'm the guy that's fun to hit, but holy damn.
Everyone has their turn with me, Jesse. Even Mike did.
Yep.
But now we can go on to
the story we're just dying this share.
It's the timey-wimey stuff.
So, for some reason, they decided that I would somehow invent time travel.
We eventually turned into we.
It started with me.
It started with sorry. Sorry.
Excuse me?
You said me, and for some reason I...
He wants the credit for it, damn it.
I repeat
How
it.
Dare you invite?
I don't know why, I just wanted
invite.
To...
Invite? Who did he invite?
Himself! Time travel!
Sorry.
So anyway.
I don't know why, I just... Somehow I just, like, repeated what you said.
So anyway, so it started... with them saying that somehow I invented time travel. Don't ask us how we get on these subjects. But, wonderful throw. But I invented time travel somehow. But my future self came back in time to tell me to not invent it because it made me too tired in the morning to continue on, so I didn't invent it. And then
it just slowly kind of evolved. I don't remember what exactly came next. But eventually, we were just coming up with scenarios where our future selves jump in, tell us to stop what it is we're doing, what it is we're doing, in order to prevent some future event. And so, it's coming into where, like, future selves are coming in to say stop to our past future selves to stop and not tell us to not do the thing.
Does your head hurt yet?
If your head hurts... You're getting it.
So basically, kind of painting them a picture. So basically, first Mike pops in, stop. You're gonna be up all night inventing time travel, and then the scenario, the future Jesse pops in, stop. I forget what the scenario was for a reason I pop in, but then future Joey pops in, says stop. Don't tell Mike to invent time travel. Tell me to invite time travel.
Invite.
Invite. Invent. Same invest.
But, invest in time travel.
So we're constantly trying to stop each other from inventing time travel because we're abusing the time travel ability.
Yep.
Yeah.
Eventually we decided that what actually created it... Should we go into Code Pants?
Nope. It's a mystery.
We'll keep that a mystery.
Alright, Code Pants will be a mystery. Sorry,
yes.
Everyone.
Yeah. I tried in episode 1, but no, you guys stopped me. So now has to be a lucrative secret that we cannot reveal.
Forever. A lucrative secret. This secret is earning us money? Where the hell's the money? That's the one who came up with it.
Jesse, you're stealing it, aren't you?
You thieving bastard.
Future Jesse Possum. Stop! Ah, crap, too late.
Give us the money or I'll kill him. You heard me, future Jesse. You get back here.
I'm in tears. So it was like, we were just out, getting dinner, and then we just went into, like, reasons that our future selves would just appear. So it got to the point where just very minor things would just cause our future selves to just tell us stop whatever we're doing.
Yeah, I'd gone to the bathroom and the first thing they asked me when I came back is how many future selves came and told you to stop.
So now we're just an occasion where it's like we do something very minor and the other person would go, stop! And we just conjure up that your future self disappears.
It evolved into our future selves daring our past selves to go back and prank our God, that's difficult. Future selves pranking our past selves on a bet to tell them to stop doing whatever that they're doing. For no reason.
Like, so far my favorite one is like we were driving and you came up with one and you said, hey, stop. And it's like, wait, wrong time. And your character, and your future self pops away. It's like, oh.
No, stop. Wait, Oh, wrong time, sorry. Just go away. It's like,
This makes it worse.
You could have told me. I totally pranked myself doing that.
You totally...
I messed up.
Totally realize that if you want your future self to do something, all you have to do is tell them, like, go to the past and tell them, don't do this. And when if you had no inclination of doing it, you bet your ass you'll be interested in doing it all of a sudden.
Yeah. So, I imagine there's going to be future episodes or bits or podcasts where you're just going to hear us stop and we just immediately start laughing because that's we're conjuring a future.
Stop! Don't tell them!
Make them wonder.
They'll earn us more money! Jesse will steal!
That thieving bastard!
I'm the vessel of
no man. Wonder why he has so many electronics!
That rift. I need to confiscate it for evidence.
I think I need to confiscate the D&D stuff. Hi! I love how he yells about that more than the rift.
Well,
to be fair, you probably spent about the same...
Let's see. 600 headset, 200 controllers, books, miniatures... Oh, sweet Moses.
Yeah.
Doesn't seem unfeasible now, does it?
I need to get some receipts.
You need to get some restraints.
Then there's all the retro stuff over there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the legions of old games for systems that are not supported anymore.
NES, Famicom, Genesis.
There's three golden games over there.
Yes.
Legend of Zelda, Legend of Zelda, and...
The other one is a reproduction cart of the Nintendo World Championship that I got a reproduction cart, and then I just got a non-working Zelda cart and basically took...
Transplanted it.
Yeah, basically transplanted it. So it has thrown so many people off. Like, I don't tell them that it's a reproduction. I with the intent of telling them later on, but I just carry around because it's one of the, you know, holy grail of, like, rare games. So it's like for me to just do this for kicks and giggles. But some people, a lot of times, like, they see that, and then usually, like, later on, they hear how rare it is, and they're like, Jesse, do you know what you have? I'm like, what are you talking about? It's like, that gold card. It's like, which one? It's like, the one of the Nintendo Championships. Oh, that one. It's like, you know how much money that is? It's a reproduction card. Oh.
No, you should totally just, like, make them think that you really have something worth, like, $10,000.
Just gasp and walk away.
It's like, wow, that's cool.
That's really hard to do when they're calling me on the phone. Just put the phone down and walk away.
It's mic drop.
I'm sorry, I dropped my phone and completely fainted. In sheer surprise. Why did I hear you laughing like a maniac in the background?
Just quietly say, damn it, and hang up.
Shit, they're on to me.
If only that I was that good of a liar.
Well, I mean, you've lied to us about stealing all the money for so long. You're obviously
good at
it.
You're pretty good at it, yes.
You pulled no level of evidence. Just pure accusations have not...
All the evidence I or Joe need is that we don't have the money. That's proof that we don't have the money and you do.
It's the way our government works right now, damn it. We're following that.
If we don't have it, you do. You need to pay us now.
Here's the thing. I'm keep trying to say the only reason, like, only evidence you've proven is...
Objection!
Is interrupting me before I can explain.
No, you dare. Wait, stop.
We don't need excuses. We just need the money.
This is a very off-topic podcast.
Yeah, we were thinking, it's like, we're going to talk about more video game memories. We haven't mentioned a single damn one yet.
And we're at the 45-minute mark.
Yes, we are. 34.
That says 34, Jesse.
For heaven's... Oh.
He can't see through his greed. You keep trying to lowball us, Jesse. It's really alright.
Lowball, that's a higher value, I declared. It's 4 worth more than you're, 5 to you now?
You're telling us it's a higher amount than it really is.
That's not lowballing.
That's not lowballing, Jesse.
That's gracious.
If he's over, say,
if he's saying that he's giving you $20 and he's handing you a 10 and you believe him, he's lowballing you.
Okay.
I've broken him. I'm wonderful.
You're making up a scenario that anyone above an intelligence of 5 would know.
Well, I'm sorry if my characters are bird brain.
I like going full circle.
Apparently I have an affinity for stupid rogues. Although that one's a real knuckle dragger, I have to be honest.
Oh, God.
Best episode ever. I'm not sure for you guys, but I'm having a freaking blast. Oh, sweet. Most. Oh.
He's actually crying a little bit. It's wonderful.
Ah. Goodness sake. So yeah, we're going to talk about video games at some point.
Someday.
Over the rainbow.
Jesse gives us our money. So we can buy them.
So we can actually afford it. I'm really sorry, future Jesse. There's a lot of audio spikes, but it's mostly your fault. Because you're a dirty thief. Apparently, the thought of him stealing money from us is funny. See?
It brings him such joy. He's an evil, evil man.
Sure, he looks neutral.
Or good, even. You know, the Mormon is just sheer fakeness.
Are you saying I'm using that for cover?
Yes! Yes, and he admits it!
It was a question!
It sounded like a confession to me. What do you say?
That was a statement.
You're not the good. You're not the bad cop and asshole cop now.
What are you talking about? Our investigative prowess is amazing.
I have a Marvel.
We have 100% track record. I'm like your only perp.
I have a marvelous intelligence. I know. I can perceive these things.
With your 4 intelligence. I did actually not expect this podcast to go into roasting each other.
Just name this the roast.
There we go.
We don't need anything.
Oh god. Podcast 3, the roast.
4.
4.
See, this is where that
I'm the low bar.
That's where that intelligence plays in.
There can't be more episodes than he has intelligence.
Are you now saying this is the last episode of the podcast?
No, they'll just all be numbered 4 after this.
like 4 1/4, 4 1/4. Just go down like fraction increments. Oh, God.
I'm actually tempted to name the next one 4.
No. Or just put the number 4.
Yep. No decimal points, it's just 4. Because 4 point something is still higher than 4.
Yeah.
And I'm even worse with fractions.
Oh, God.
No, just instead of the number 4, you do the word 4.
Like the spelling it out?
Yes.
We have the numeric value, we have it spelled. We have to, like, put it in different languages or something.
Yep.
There we go.
Or different. Gosh, we have access to different fonts. We don't have to go very creative. We vent codes.
There we go. That'd get really confusing. Episode 4, wait, what?
Where are.
Wait, it's like, okay, what's the sequence of four? Now here it is. It's first the numeric, then the alphabetic, then it's Russian, then it's Spanish, then it's Japanese. You know, there's a there's an easy sequence to remember.
Half of the audience. We're having a discussion about the number four. What is this podcast becoming?
And then you accidentally upload one of your Golf with Drunks episodes on it. And it four again.
Four? I don't think we've ever said four in all of Golf with Drunks. I just realized that.
Then you are a disgrace. And a thief.
The mic was the disgrace.
That's true.
How dare you turn this around, you disgraceful bastard?
Oh, man.
If our audience has not passed out from laughter by now,
then we are not as funny as we are.
We should put a warning. Do not listen in public. You'll probably find yourself waffling in public.
Hashtag send pics.
You have very interesting laugh patterns in the audio.
I know! It's ha 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 as I see it.
Yes, that.
We're just watching our voices being captured in sound waves.
You're also the loudest one. Like, I would have to speak like this, and I'm not even as loud as you.
That's impressive!
Oh, God.
Jesus Christ. Jesse has a higher voice than us.
Yeah.
Yes, he does.
Yes.
So, actual subjects.
Let's talk about five.
Too high of a number.
Right.
I have to roll for intelligence to see if I can count that high. Yes, grab
are we actually 20. Grabbing the dice?
Yes, now. Yes, we are. Okay. Let's see if I can, how high I can count.
Okay.
All right. Minus three.
13.
Okay, so we can add up to 13 episodes.
I like it. That's one way to
have. I would have laughed if he did one. You rolled the nat one. It's just like, well,
we would have to, wait, one? Minus three.
Negative four.
That's not... That's the intelligence.
That's not the same.
Yes. Oh, God.
Don't hire us for math tutoring.
No, just don't hire me.
Oh, man. Wait for like Mike, I need help with this problem. Shoo!
Oh man.
I feel like every time we say, let's get on a subject,
we're just gonna go to some other random subject. Cause I don't even know what video game memories to go on now. They're all gone. They're just like, what are games?
Burp. So for me, I usually for me, like I know, and our past video game memories is, I went very, very little of like memories of when I had a Game Boy, and that was a huge part of my childhood, because as I said in previous segments, the consoles we owned were my brother, so we had to share, but the Game Boy that I eventually got was my own, and this is like the first original gray brick Game Boy.
How much money did you need to steal to get that?
I was four!
Wow, he's
full
started.
Circle! Full circle!
He started young.
Now we need to change the name of this one to four. Well, it is already four, actually.
We need to change it to four. It's already four. Change it anyway, Mr. Jensen.
Junior will kill him.
I swear to God. And derailed successfully.
So continue telling us about your thieving ways, Jesse.
Yes, do
so,
tell.
So it started when I had a game genie, and I'm literally cheating the game. This is a true story. I would play Super Mario Land. At the time, it would be one of those games where I could not play without the game genie. And, oh my gosh, it's one of the things kind of ridiculous where it's like, the Game Boy itself is already, you know, pretty big. But also, like, this giant genie on top, so it's like a tower that I'm basically holding as a little kid. And I'm like, and it's always funny looking at these little, you just, like, looking at my old photos, like, just me as a little kid. And it's like, I just look like I'm just holding, like, a giant, like, radio, like, back in those days. And it's like, I'm playing this, and again, perspective, it's just a tiny little screen in this giant device. But I played this way, the Game Boy, to your childhood. I basically went through all the generations of Game Boys, and one of my favorite memories is I was over at my grandparents, and it was basically my mom had to run out somewhere, so just my grandma was tending me, and I was watching TV with her, and she's like, "Hey Jesse, I got a surprise for you." I was like, "What?" And so she goes around the room, she comes out with Pokemon Gold and Silver. And I just lost my mind. It's like, oh my gosh. So I immediately opened them up, going through the manuals, checking out the game cartridges. Like, oh, these are cool. They're actually gold and silver. It's cool. And then my mom comes in and it's like, Mom, look, Grandma got me. And she has the look of sheer terror. Because those were games for my birthday. But my grandma just, because of her old age, she just forgot. She didn't know why she had them. She was like, oh, these are Pokemon. I don't know. My grandson loves these games. So, luckily, my birthday wasn't too far, so I wasn't too mad. It was like, okay, I just pack everything up the best I could and just gave them back. But it's just one of those funny things. Like, if my birthday was farther, I would have been so pissed.
It would have been like, just buy me new ones, you cheapskates.
And
it's not my fault Grandma has terrible memory.
So then it's funny that, and also on that same birthday, like on top of that, I got the Game Boy Color, which blew me away, but then it's followed by, you know, when I got the Pokemon games, like, I wonder what these are. And so that was like one of my early fondest memories of, you know, with the Game Boys.
The time you got gypped at a Pokemon game.
Well, that's one of my favorite memories, because it's just, for me, I'm able to laugh at it now, and I even laughed at it as a kid. It just... It's like, oh, okay, and just handed them back. So I just out of curiosity, it's like, where did you guys join in the Game Boy line?
Well, I already kind of mentioned it previously. basically, it was Christmas one year, and I didn't actually get the original Game Boy. That's actually the one handheld from Nintendo I never got. Uh-huh. I actually started off with the Game Boy Color with getting Pokemon. And a couple of other games, like Mousetrap Hotel, the Pokemon Trading Card Game.
Yeah.
You know, those kind of games. But the first games, I really, truly remember Pokemon Red and Blue. I got those with the Game Boy Color. And I believe I mentioned, you know, my troubles in that first night.
Yes,
I couldn't leave the house.
Couldn't figure out how to get out of the house.
Yes. But after that, it was just playing through it, and my mom started playing red version. I played blue version. Mm-hmm. I remember my first starter was a Bulbasaur. That was the first Pokemon I got. And I remember that game was actually hard as a child. Yeah, you know, because it's like, what's weird is I spent a lot more time playing it. You know, it took longer to play it than it would nowadays. But I had more issues with Gary, especially.
Yeah.
In Sylph Tower, oh God, Gary was hard.
Yeah, that's why like Pokemon for me as a child is one of those games where, luckily my brother Justin was big into it too, so he had the funds to get the strategy guides. So I would get to go over the strategy guides along with them too. So basically, both me and my brother learned Pokemon together.
Yeah. Well, I think my biggest problem was I kept trying to implement the anime logic into the games.
Yeah, that's bad.
Yeah. Because Ash ignores.
Just believe types. In yourself. Anything can happen.
Pikachu, why aren't you shocking him? You knocked out Geodude in the anime.
Same thing here. It's like, why are you... I saw you one-shot kill Bulbasaur, then an electric attack. Why is it working now?
Yeah.
They've gotten better with that, though. Types. Yeah. Since the original.
Well, of course I have.
No. The anime.
The anime.
Oh,
They've gotten better than actually.
You've gotten better, too.
Yeah. Don't feel bad.
No. We believe in you. We're on the friendship.
I was wondering when I was going to get roasted. There we go. I was feeling left out. I wasn't being picked on. Friendship can't sail without equal insults.
That's like engraved into the bone.
Everyone must be shit on equally.
that's a friendship too.
Yep. Truly is. You can't shit on your friends and have a good time with it. You're not actually friends.
Yep. But I remember I was totally on that Pokemon bandwagon, you know, the yes. Pokemon cards.
Oh, hell yeah.
I had the little, like, Pokedex book that had all the... Hell, I even had the little toy Pokedex.
I still have mine.
I don't.
Funny.
You thieving bastard!
See, now he's admitting it.
Yeah, exactly!
I did admit it.
Even before I officially knew him, he was stealing.
I just said funny.
And then looked at me with clearly, like, I have it now.
Yeah, a look. And apparently it's like, arrest this man at once. We have enough evidence to put him behind bars.
Viewers, in the comments, tell us whether you think that statement sounded like a confession. Let us know.
That's great. Is there going to be hashtags bad crump now?
Not bad. Just thieving crump. Hashtag thieving bastard crump.
Alright, so as far as my experience with Game Boys, I did start on the original, but it was quite late. I believe my cousin had gotten the Game Boy Advance SP.
Wow, that late.
Holy shit.
Yeah. No, not Advance, sorry, a Game Boy Color.
Oh, thank God.
Okay.
I was about to say, this is going to be 2000.
Game Boy. Yeah,
No, sorry, said the wrong thing. Yeah, no, the Game Boy Color is the light up one. Yes, the SP.
That was the SP. The SP was the first one to light up.
Yeah. Yeah, it's Game Boy Color.
No, the Game Boy
Color didn't have a backlight. Wait.
No, Game Boy Color didn't have a backlight.
How many future mics are going on their way right
stop,
now?
Stop.
Sorry, I get confused easily. Low intelligence. So I think he just still did have the... it was at least the original Game Boy Advance. And he gave me the Game Boy Color because he didn't need it.
Let's give you visual aid to kind of give you an idea.
Game Boy Color... Game Boy Advance, Game Boy SP, DS, so on. I know
there's a pocket, but we don't really count that.
Game Boy Micro or
Game,
whatever.
Not pocket or micro, those were just smaller iterations.
Yeah, so anyway, I think it was the Advance that he had, and he still had the original one, and he gave that to me along with Yellow, Pokemon Yellow, so we all started with Pokemon.
Yeah.
And...
Which version did you play first?
It was technically my brother's, and it was Pokemon Red that I mostly watched.
We went to the difference again. Really? Red and Yellow. Now, if those two were flipped, we would have had our Pokemon Go teams.
Yes. So, it's just funny. Well, wait, so the first one we owned was Red, but it was technically my brother's. My first ever Pokemon game I owned was Yellow.
Yeah.
So, is this fun? Actually, yeah, I do have a... of memory with like Pokemon Red. It's like I had the original brick. We didn't have the color at the time, and I was playing Pokemon Red, and then we're at a water polo meet, and I was just watching. My brother was playing. We're watching. I was showing my sister the Pokedex. I was basically my brother let me borrow the cartridge, so I was playing it, and then I was like, as I was showing what Pokemon my brother caught, the Game Boy slipped, and then it fell onto the ground, and it shut off the game, and I opened it. The save was erased.
Oh.
That was not a good day.
No.
Because it's followed by, Justin, I kind of deleted everything. Needless to say, he was not too happy with it, but...
anyway, you keep hijacking me.
Yeah, sorry.
Thief bastard. So, I played Yellow First quite late in the game. I very soon found a discounted Game Boy Color, and I had that for a while. And I played... God, I don't even remember now. I played a couple games on that one for a while, and I did eventually get an advance at the end of that, or when they started going into the SP.
Mm-hmm.
And I played a lot of the old the DBZ games on those, which were quite fun. I played them in class, blatantly in front of the teachers, and they were not appreciative.
Really?
Yeah.
Who would have thought?
Yeah. Probably why I can't count.
maybe that's the source of the problem.
Imagine
the future mic now popping in. It's like you playing your Game Boy. Stop! I can't funk if you don't. If you stop playing that.
ADD's a bitch. Anyway. But yeah, that's what I had, and then. Into the DS's. I started with the DSi, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I started with the DSi, and then I got the 3DS, and now I have the XL.
The new 3DS.
Yeah, I got the XL, and then I got the new 3DS XL. God, that's hard to say.
I know, that's a weird name. Gosh, what were they thinking of marketing for that? It's like, it's not the 3DS, it's the new 3DS XL.
That's weird.
Yeah.
But nonetheless.
So, actually, in reference to your, like, accidentally causing your brother's save file to be erased, I accidentally erased my save file with Mew in it.
Oh.
Oh, man.
Yeah. That... Yeah. Well, okay, to be fair, I didn't quite realize that... I didn't quite make the connection when somebody asked if they could start a new game.
Yeah, that's how... I had a lot of stories.
Yeah, because I was letting a friend in elementary school play it, and I had Mew on that. And they started playing it, and they just saved. And so I go in, and I'm like, what?
I think that's one of the most common stories I hear, like, from our generation is always a friend, little brother, little sister wants to play it, rather, you know, with permission or without permission, goes to new game.
Yeah.
And that,
I don't have any siblings, but I think I did that to myself because the first day I got that original Game Boy and was playing a Yellow on it, I didn't save the entire day, and then at the end of the day I just shut it off.
Oh.
So I spent the entire day playing it, erased all of my data, started over the next day.
Oh.
I didn't even know about saving.
Yeah, that's why I'm kind of grateful in the newer generation Pokemon games. Like, they make it, you know, it's not common knowledge how to get to new game. It's like you have to like push like all the buttons in a, you know, like certain buttons in a sequence to conjure up the new game setting. And
One hand, that's cool. On the other, it's kind of annoying.
Yeah, because you have to keep. For me, it's like I have to keep Googling how to do it.
Yep. But,
yeah.
Yeah, let's see. So, ever since the Game Boy, I followed the Game Boy line pretty closely.
Yeah.
I didn't actually get, except for I didn't get the DSi or the DS Lite or any of those. Yeah. I actually just got the old brick DS.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I actually have two of those now. Because one of them, my oldest sister, had left theirs when they had moved out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so they have that one and another one. And it's just like, okay, well, I have two DSs now.
Awesome for Pokemon trading and the.
Yeah, but I actually got a lot of the peripherals with the game that I had never ended up using. Like, for example, with Fire Red, do you remember when they kind of released that those weird wireless transfer?
Yeah, those wireless transfer stuff.
Mm. Never have used it. Not once.
Yeah, because it's one of those things. You have to have one, and you got to count on someone else having one. Yeah,
that whole like transfer thing and the link cables way back when was really annoying.
Oh, so God.
Remember Four Swords Adventures?
Yes.
So you could play it. You know, like you had the thing for the GameCube, so we could play it on the TV. But if me and you wanted to play it, we each had to have a link cable, and we each had to have a Game Boy to be able to do it.
Yep.
And yeah. That's a lot to ask.
Yeah,
it's a very specific cable.
Yeah, I mean, it's... And, I mean, I understand why they did it, because each person needs to have their own screen, but it's still annoying.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, it's with like Nintendo didn't believe in split screen at the time, apparently.
Yeah, and it's really. Like, and it's kind of one of those things where in our generation where it's like some of us, you know, we're not of wealth, so don't you dare say thief. So
you take it.
So for me, I know none of my friends, if I told them, oh, well, this is a fun game, I'll buy it, and then you have to buy your own cable.
Yeah, that'll go over well with a bunch of kids.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to buy your own copy of the game if you want to play it with me.
No, you don't. Not for Four Swords. You only needed one copy of the game. They just needed a Game Boy Advance and the cable connector for that.
And that's very difficult when it's like, you want to play a game for me, buy the console and a specific cable.
Yeah. In fact, it wasn't the only game that did that either. Final Fantasy Crystal Shards. No, Crystal Chronicles.
Crystal Shards. Yeah, our Pokemon series is starting to kill us. Everything with crystals got him shards now.
Did you know we got a comment on the video asking, like, wondering why it wasn't banned?
Yeah, because of the sense, they kind of, it's like, because I was all the, I'm pretty sure the commenting did, like, all the censoring I did, like, kind of a joke, like, why was this episode banned? But again, I'm assuming that's the context.
Perhaps, I don't know. I kind of want to point out, it's like, to be fair, This is tame compared to a lot of crap on YouTube. CNNers in particular.
Yep.
Let's
throw a YouTuber under the bus. Let's do this. Let's roast everyone. Let's get going.
Roast CNNers.
He can't touch us.
We're only a tiny YouTube channel.
We can do whatever I want. We like living on the edge.
We end up getting to that million subscriber count, and so, like, he ends up coming and seeing this video. It's just like, those dicks.
And also, we see us being referenced in his videos. Like, hey guys, I was watching a video. It's called this YouTube channel called The Ones in the Corner. And
shit!
Immediately we go there. It's
like, we're like, we're sorry. Please don't touch us.
I'm not. Fuck off.
In our future selves, they don't say, stop this, stand behind us. It's like, that was all you, dude.
Why didn't you warn them? I don't care.
Yeah, it's like, you'll be, I don't care. I'd be like, I didn't, I couldn't predict this. Like, again, we're going up with, like, alternate universes kind of stuff, so it's not just one continuous timeline, because that would break everything. So.
Yeah, because we realized, if you went to stop yourself from creating a time machine, how could you go back in time to prevent yourself from making the time machine?
Yeah, that's where it just, like, again, gets to head-hurting territory.
Yep. Time is a paradox. You can't think about moving forward or backwards in time without breaking everything.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, jumping forward in time, because we're always moving in time.
Yes.
We're already time-traveling.
Stop getting so deep, Joey. This isn't a science channel.
Oh, God.
It's whatever we want it to be channel.
That's true.
So again, link cables.
Ah, yes. They sucked.
They did.
I've never had a good experience with the link cables. I don't know how many times I've had to finagle with them to randomly get them to decide, all right, now we'll work.
Yeah, because Because there's no, like I said, it's just one of those moments where it's like you have to be, you know, like, or at least in my case, like, you know, your person has to be far enough in the game, and usually, again, I only used Link Cable for Pokemon, so it's like, so they have to be far enough in the game, we gotta be, it's like, when I was saying, if it wasn't working, like, okay, do we have to be in the exact same Pokemon Center? Crap, I don't want to fly, so you know, like, all these theories. Again, we didn't have good enough internet at the time in order to communicate how to properly use these outside from the instruction, you know, the manual that we mostly just threw away with the packaging.
And those Link cables were finicky as hell.
Yes.
They just randomly decide, nah, I don't feel like working right now.
That's why I was so happy when the random DS came out and introduced the ways of wireless communication without any adapters. It's in the system.
You know, I never actually got any of the DS Pokemon games.
Is it during a time where you just kind of fell out of it?
Yeah, it was basically, I ended up kind of falling out of Pokemon kind of a little bit after Sapphire, Ruby, and Emerald.
Yeah.
And, yeah, it was, you know, it seems like everyone of our generation went through that time where elementary school to early junior high, Pokemon! You know, and then junior high to high school, man, that's a kid's game. We don't care about that. Yeah. Then college, Pokemon!
Yeah, pretty much. For me, yeah. It's like my falling out was after Gold and Silver because I found that time when Ruby and Sapphire were kind of a thing. I transitioned into Yu-Gi-Oh! And I was huge into that.
Yeah. The Yu-Gi-Oh! Trading card game?
Yeah, trading card game. Got into the anime, begged my mom to get me a Seto Kaiba starter deck because I wanted a freaking Blue-Eyes White Dragon.
I went with the Yu-Gi starter deck.
Nice.
But, God, I've had those cards stolen so damn many times.
That's the other thing.
Yeah, like, that was the bad thing about the cards. Trading cards go to school, they get stolen.
Man, the damn time.
But it's like the only place where you can play them. Because like for me, it's like during that, you know, around junior high, it's like those, you know, the people at junior high were the only people like we would play with.
Yep.
And they banned them at school.
Yep, because they were having so many problems with kids stealing them that they're just like, screw it, they're being banned. Then I got into Magic the Gathering.
Yep.
Actually, interestingly enough, the thieving of my Yu-Gi-Oh cards was the primary reason I stopped caring about Yu-Gi-Oh.
Ah.
That and the TV show just kind of started getting lamer and lamer.
Yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
But yeah, the biggest reason was the thieving. Yeah. Then I got into Magic the Gathering. I got a kind of a big, like, initial chunk of Magic cards from my brother-in-law and my nephew. And, you know, I got, our old friend Buddy into it. Then Mike kind of got into it. We usually kind of let him borrow cards for a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we played that for several years. If we weren't playing Magic the Gathering, we were playing RuneScape on the computer at the library.
Yep.
Yeah.
Almost everyone everyone at my work, if they play MMOs or play computer games, they've played RuneScape. It was kind of like baby's first MMO kind of thing.
Because one didn't, you know, played it in a browser, free, unless you wanted to go premium, and so that was so, and at least for me, like it ran on computers at home, like they were basically just computers that are only made for just word processing and stuff, never for games.
Yep, and it was the MMO that people could play and get like that WoW experience without, you know, because their parents wouldn't pay for WoW.
Yeah, so it's...
So, yeah, RuneScape was a big part of my junior high years.
Yeah, same here.
For me, it wasn't until around high school, just because there was no one really talking about RuneScape. It was all about Magic the Gathering and Yu-Gi-Oh! within my circle of friends. It was like, I never played Magic Gathering around that time, but I was very well aware of it. And I still remember at one point, one of my friends, we tried playing Magic the Gathering. Yeah, he played his Magic Gathering cards, and I would play Yu-Gi-Oh! we would, and but it was like with, you know, slight point conversion, he wiped the floor, mainly because like the points are way off. Like in Yu-Gi-Oh, the attacks and defenses are like in the thousands. It's just a single point value in Magic. So we wondered, okay, we'll just times that by 1,000. Big mistake! I gave him a freaking boon! It's like, I eventually got to the point where he had like 4,000 attack on creatures. And it's like, well,
Yeah, the thing is that around the time that would have been the case, the highest level monster that he could have gotten would have had 13,000.
Yeah. So we were just bored at lunch. It's like, I want to play Yu-Gi-Oh? Want to play Magic? Neither of us had the cards. Like, let's try something.
Yeah.
But he never did it since because he realized how overpowered he was. It's like, we can't balance this at all.
No.
Yeah. You pull out something like a Corrosion Cloud Scraper or Corrosion Colossus, and those have 10 to 13 attack points.
Yeah.
And that's overkill.
Because, like, we first thought, like, oh, by the hundreds, and we're like, that's extremely unfair, because everything's thousands, so that was the only way we could figure out how to balance it. But then it's like, I can't destroy
it. Honestly, it would have been better to divide your attacks by 1,000, to make yours be, like, 4-4, 3-3, you know, and just make anything under 1,000, like, 1-1.
Yeah, we didn't think of that at the time.
That may have worked, but...
May have worked.
Yeah, that's a very big may. Yeah,
but the amount of things that you can summon compared to what they can summon, it's still
balanced. Yeah, they just have to tap, I have to sacrifice monsters. Yeah, so I was very familiar with Magic, I never got into it. It's like, I've always thought about buying the cards, but it's like, now it's just like, there's no point, because unless we were all players again, that's the only reason I would say get into it.
The thing is like, I'd love to play a game with you of Magic the Gathering, and I think you'd really like it.
Yes, I know.
The problem is, though, is that I don't want to get into the hobby again. It's an expensive D&D's an expensive hobby, and really all you need is a couple of books and you can create an infinite number of characters.
Yeah,
but in this case, it's like, you know, the D&D, or in Magic the Gathering's case, you almost need to be constantly buying more cards.
If you want to stay relevant to any degree.
Yeah. Or, you know, you want to make a really awesome deck, and you just keep getting into the habit of, I need better cards, I want to get more booster packs, I want to get more sets, I want to get more...
Yeah.
You know, I mean, don't get me wrong, it's a... fun hobby. I loved it when I was into it. But then it's like, the only person I knew at the time that really was into it with me turned more into a collector. You know, he stopped caring about playing, mostly because I beat him all the time.
Yeah.
But,
God, the first time I beat him,
he was so salty.
Oh my god, yes.
The salt was real.
He rage quit and stormed out of the building, nearly flipped the damn table.
Wow.
Yeah, he did not take losses well. Now he's mostly a collector. And I still have all my cards, you know. Same. I actually here. Have enough to make several more decks, and I've actually thought about doing it, but...
I do two and actually...
I'm, like, at risk of it. I don't really want to get into this series again, because... I'll just spend hundreds of dollars I don't have, you know?
Yeah, so... And that's what I love when the comment that Total Biscuit made is like, you see, kind of realize, like, we always comment about video games being expensive. And it's like, think about other hobbies.
Yeah, seriously, just reading. If you go to a bookstore and pick up any book, holy shit, I went to the bookstore and bought 2 books. I spent $80.
Yeah, D&D books, you're specific, right?
No. One was The Silmarillion, and the other was this random fantasy novel.
Really?
Yes. Regular books. Reading is an expensive hobby now.
Yeah.
You know, and that's if you want to read an actual paper book, which is how I prefer to read.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, reading online is fine. You know, I read fan fiction a lot, but there's something nice about holding a book and just opening it and reading a book.
Yeah, so that's what I love when people harp, you know, any people that harp on me, like, oh, video games being expensive, I always... say, look at, you know, other hobbies. Like, one of them was whenever my sister cuts on my case, and it's like, she has, like, she says, oh, video games are expensive, but it's like, she has, like, probably, like, 8 totes just full of DVDs and Blu-rays. And I'm like, you hark on me on this, I hark on you on this.
Yeah.
We equal now? Kind of a thing.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, watching movies. So you're looking at minimum, like, $10 a movie. Usually, like, more like
if you
20.
Don't, if you don't go special edition stuff.
Yeah. But if you get the special edition stuff, you're looking at $40, $30, you know?
Yeah.
Per movie. And if you buy a ton of them, how often do you really watch all those movies?
Yeah, and all that
stuff. You know, so that's an expensive hobby. Just watching TV now is an expensive hobby.
Yeah, where are you spending your $500 a month?
Yeah, exactly, you know? It's like, video games, yes, it seems like a large amount, but in reality, everything's expensive now. Watching TV, what? I mean, seriously, about the only way you can really, like, have a hobby where you just mindlessly sit and watch something for cheap are those video streaming services. Netflix, Hulu,
Crunchyroll.
Not sponsored.
God. I wish.
Crunchyroll! Which representatives of Crunchyroll sponsors? We don't talk about anime, mind you.
Don't send the check to Jesse, though.
He's a thieving bastard.
Imagine that would be the code. It'd be like crunchyroll.com/thievingbastard.
Please, if we ever get sponsored, have the promo code be thieving bastard. For the love of God.
I do not think that they would accept it.
If we have to get approval from them first. But even that. We would go in town on the pitch, though.
You can be a thieving bastard by signing up.
We'd have to give a thieving, like, themed anime or something to throw in. So, like, you can be a thieving bastard, like Lupin the Third. See, I saved it.
Or Case Closed.
Yeah, there you go.
I got nothing.
I imagine we just the camera just panned to you and be like, I got nothing.
Yes, the camera in the podcast.
But I'm talking about the pitch. Like, we gotta shoot a video pitch. And then we got nothing.
He stole my idea. You dirty thief.
So don't listen to anything that Joey says. Get your creepy mother on us.
But, yeah, that is pretty much the only way nowadays you can have a relatively cheap hobby. But in order to watch any of those, you have to pay for the internet. You have to pay for whatever device that you're going to be streaming it through, your computer. Tablets now can do it, but they're not very good at it. You know, there's video game consoles, which again...
And you're paying for premium in that case, probably.
Yeah,
because
access to, you know, some places...
Access to their internet services, which you're required to have that, you know... I mean, your anything today.
So what
can
we're saying
be...
is PC Master Race for life.
Yes.
No. What we're saying is don't harp on games because guess what? You're spending just as much money on whatever you like.
Yeah.
Not that anyone who doesn't like games is gonna watch our channel. We're a video game channel.
Well,
we're trying to be.
We have one video that does not have anything to do with video games.
Drew!
What video?
The news one.
Our fake news broadcast.
Oh,
For Science, remember?
Yeah. That's a good way to remember it.
For Science!
And for those... So, if we could pitch that...
And you haven't seen it, just look in the link in the description below.
Yes.
I'll put
a link. Future Jesse will put a link.
Or an annotation. Or else. Something. Yes. Or else we'll kill him!
So... It was linked to
it. Take our money.
I like how he laughs when we threaten his life.
I know the kind of character is fun to hit. And even the death threats are even, you know, still just as funny.
Future me. Threaten future Jesse.
I'm sure it will happen.
So, So yeah, I wanted to share a little backstory with it. It's basically, I was in a class, laughter yoga. Yes, that is a real class. Yes, I did take it. And it's basically, the final assignment I had to do, there were many other projects I could choose.
You have to laugh like that character from Final Fantasy XII?
Luckily not. I did not.
Ten. Sorry, ten.
I did not have to go,
Never do that again.
We just lost our audience, I know.
At least you're not laughing like the gas guy from One Piece. What's his name? The gas gas fruit guy.
Are we still on the Crunchyroll pitch?
I'm pushing it, damn it.
I actually don't know, but that's going to bug me now.
You know who I'm talking about, though?
Yes, I do.
He has the most annoying laugh, and I was so glad when that arc ended. Because I couldn't stand his damn laugh anymore.
Gotcha.
Carry on.
So, one of the projects I chose was to do a fake news story. Now...
Caesar.
That's right. Carry on.
I was like... You know, as a non-person doesn't watch One Piece, I was so confused. It's like, Caesar. It's like...
Salads?
Or little?
Camper?
Or little?
My liege.
Anyways, well, I did a dupe come with a fake news story. Now, it was when I basically went all in it, because around that time I did acquire a green screen from one of my cousins, and I said, let's just go all out on this kind of fake news story, because originally... The whole, does this hurt, was a segment me and Joey came up with while we're in his driveway one day. It was just going to be a skit. And then when I thought fake news story, I wanted to convert that into Joey was a researcher for a news broadcast.
And I needed to, and I decided to go mad scientist and find out what hurt Tanner.
Yes.
A lot of things.
Yeah, so that's how that kind of evolved. And so that's what. So that was the kind of inspiration for that video.
We spent
video.
Like a day laughing about it before we actually filmed it.
Yeah. So go ahead and watch this after this podcast, I recommend. Don't leave. Come back. Where are you going? Stop!
Future you will come and tell you to
stop. Your future self will come and tell Now that's a pitch. Your future self will.
Well, they'd be more likely to press it now because I would just be like, "I want to see this happen." You lied to me.
Great. I'm gonna get a "see how you lied to me" in the comments.
To be fair, we are currently talking to our future thems.
Well, that's past us coming to talk to their future selves.
This is confusing.
I know I smell copper.
Our past us are talking to our future audience and warning them about their future selves. How do our past selves know about their future selves?
future.
I can smell the future, remember?
Touché. What does it smell like?
It smells like copper. To explain what that little tidbit meant. So, for the longest time, I had the extraordinary ability that whenever Mike's family was going to cook something good for dinner, I'd call them to see if I could come over and hang out.
And like, without fail, whenever we were making a home-cooked meal, I swear to God.
Call up, ring, ring. Hey, can you hang out? Yes. How do you know? So Mike apparently decided that meant I could smell the future.
That's his superpower.
That's my superpower. I can smell the future. And that has stuck around for years.
Yes.
Yes, it has.
That started before you moved into your current house.
Yes, it did.
Wonderful. I'm losing track.
Same.
We were talking about our fake news story, then you went to You Smell the Future.
What was before the fake news story?
What was the fake news? Oh, yeah, it was Country Roll Pitch.
Oh, yeah. Oh, entertainment.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, what?
We went about, like, the ways of entertainment and hobbies.
And why everything is so goddamn expensive.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is. That's the end of it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh,
so, so if anyone harps on you for games, just point out their flaws. Yeah. Roast them.
If you spend, you know, more than $100 on your phone every month, don't complain to me about my hobby being games.
Yeah.
You're paying way more than I do.
And just another, and I remember just my final thought on that was basically when one of my students who was telling me that they played WoW. and even said that I'm coming at the co-op, I'd love to play it, but I just can't do the monthly. And it's like, I said, I fully understand. But it's like, he even said, like, one of his friends harped on him for investing. It's like, how can you play, $15 a month for one game? And it's like, how much money do you pay for Rock Band? My point taken. Get off my case about WoW. And it's like, good. I applauded him for that. It's like, how much do you pay on plastic guitars and all this stuff for one game?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like, it's just one of those things where it's like...
That's the thing, is that a lot of those MMOs that are a subscription...
Yeah.
The reason I don't really play them isn't because I don't think they're good games or they're not worth it.
You just don't like paying the monthly fee.
Well, not only that, it's because I know for a fact that that the game will not hold my attention for long enough to make it worth it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, if I were the type to sit down and play one game nonstop, continuously, then I could see myself getting into something like EVE Online or WoW or...
And I've tried some of these a couple times, and...
None of them hold the attention long enough. Like, because we're variety gamers. All of us are. We play whatever we feel like playing at the time. This can be anything from Minecraft to... Guild Wars, to Legend of Zelda, to...
Farming Simulator.
To Farming Simulator, in Mike's case, you know.
And torturing future D&D players.
Yeah.
that's a game in its own.
You're going to have the high score.
I'm the DM, I always have the high score.
Civilization series, you know. That sort of thing. The problem is that... Since MMO, like subscription-based MMOs, you pay per month you play it, on top of usually paying for the game itself, like in WoW's case, you have to buy the game, then the expansions.
Then the next expansion.
Then the next expansion. Then
but
next
like now, it's like you have to buy over 5 expansions.
I think that the basic WoW now comes with up to the Wrath of the Lich King, and then you have to buy the Misapend area, Cataclysm... And
so it's basically the base game and the first expansion is included. Then it goes Lich King, Pandaria, then it's Cataclysm. Then gosh, I'm really trying to remember.
It's that all. Horde one.
Yeah, the
Warlords
of Draenor.
Warlords of Draenor. That's it.
And now the newest one, Legion.
That's it. So...
Nerds. I know. I'm just saying.
Oh, man. But you get my point. That's like... Over $100 for just the game without the subscription. Now, to be fair, the base game comes with a 60-day subscription, and I think each expansion comes with a 30-day subscription. So if you buy all the expansions, you're looking at about 6 months of game time.
Jesse EXE broken. We've gotten a 64-bit error.
I'm guessing Jesse...
Air 64.
I think future Jesse didn't follow one of your commands. You're killing him.
And I'll keep killing you slowly until you do what I want. Which, mind you, I've forgotten at this point. But you better do it. If you don't, and I listen to this, which I might, then the future you is going to get it.
So, future Jesse is screwed because either past him is screwed, or future him is... Wait. Future of future Jesse. The future Jesse of future Jesse is in trouble.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I was first so proud that I was able to name the expansions, and then nerd just me completely off guard.
Clearly.
Yeah. The understatement of the year, I know. But...
Yeah. This for a person, like I said, I own most of the expansions because I've just had, like, it's always, when summer hits, that's when it's just, like, a dry spell of games. So that's, sometimes, like, I miss the World of Warcraft world. So I usually just play for 1 month, and I just, you know, and that's what I play. So that's how I kind of knew when I was first very proud that you said that. It's like, I applaud you, sir.
I'm getting good at killing you, Jesse. See?
So anyway.
Death by suffocation.
So video games are an investment, is what we're trying to say.
Got a headache yet, Jesse?
Oh, man.
Yeah. But the one thing, just kind of on a comment of MMOs, the one thing I do love is the Final Fantasy 14 is now changed up their free trial to where you can play up to level 35 and it is not timed.
Yeah, I got an email about that and I was just like, ooh, that's cool. I'm not interested in playing it right now, but that's cool.
Yeah, so it's not a time event. It's not like a limited time thing. It's just now it's just like you want to... You take play up to level 35 without a subscription.
Same kind of thing with Eve happened. I was like, what? Eve's going to a free-to-play model?
Very limited.
It's very limited, though.
It's like, it's a teaser, and you'll get frustrated with it, which will prompt you to pay because you want the timer to move a little bit faster.
Yeah.
Yeah, and one reason... I mean, okay, so Eve, in general, is fun. But the mood that I get from playing that game, and I've tried it twice now for a couple of months each, is that you're paying to train a skill while you're offline doing something else. Because you set a skill to train, and it trains. It'll take, like, you know, so many hours or whatever to go, and the later levels are, you know, days and weeks to train something. So it's set it to go, do your dailies, and then log off. And I hate games where it's just the only reason you pop in is to do your dailies.
Yeah, that's what it turns like. You can go in and do like mining or missions or stuff like that, or do your regular trade route. It's the kind of game where it's busy work.
Yeah.
The game is largely busy work. Now, don't get me wrong, there are some epic things that happen in EVE Online. Like, seriously, if you look on like crack.com, you'll see some awesome stories about EVE. Like, it's famous for its gigantic space battles. Now, they don't happen often. That's one thing that a lot of people fall into. People tend to, like, the advertisements for EVE Online tend to make it seem like wars are happening all the time. These grand, epic-scale wars. They're actually pretty uncommon.
And then, when you do get in a war, because I was in a faction the first time I played it, and they got into a war for a couple of weeks, and we were stuck sitting in a space station because the other faction was camping outside of us, and if we leave, we would just die before we could even, like, render the game, you know, to get in. So, wars are a pain in the ass if you're not winning.
Yeah.
And so it's log in, set my stuff, I can't do anything else, because if I leave, I'm dead. And that's what prompted me to quit the first time.
Yep. Catch. Yeah, so the EVE Online, it's not for everyone, absolutely. In fact, some critics of it have given it the moniker paying for a second job.
Yes, but to be fair, you can earn money in it.
Yes, the actual currency in the game, ISK, I believe it's called, is actually
a real world value.
Has real world value. I think it's something like a million ISK equals $1.
It's not less than that. It's all based on how much... Okay, so the premium time can be purchased in-game with in-game currency, which is what that's kind of all based on. And right now it's... Well, last time I played it was around like 40 million in-game currency to buy 1 month of premium time with the game. And so it all kind of revolves around that.
That's what they use to equivalent it. But since you can trade that thing in the game, it actually, even like the regular ships, have in-game value. In fact, that's one of the things that makes EVE so famous, is because When ships are destroyed, they're destroyed. They're gone. They cannot be repaired. And so these wars are famous because they destroy the equivalent of millions of dollars worth of...
I mean, a single ship, like the biggest ship, is equivalent to like $10,000.
Something like... I think a little bit more than that, but...
It's somewhere... Right, so it's in the thousands. Giant
wars that destroy hundreds of thousands of ships, destroy like upwards of like hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars worth of... equipment, you know, and this is a thing, and so, you know, that's it's actually kind of cool in that regard, you know, because
right, and from talking to people that played it a lot, you can really get to the point where you can support yourself in the game as far as like buying
your own subscription.
Game time in game. You can do that in about 3 months if you do it right.
Some people, it's very rare.
And also if you have a group, you need to have a group in that game.
It's also extremely, extremely rare, but there are a handful of people that live off of EVE Online.
Yeah, but
they end up, they make so much money in the game that they sell, they're basically traders and bankers and stuff like that in the game. And they sell their, like, services, and it comes back to them in real-world money.
And I've seen people with setups, not personally, mind you, but seen pictures of people with setups where they will have several computers and, like, 15 monitors up. Each monitor has a different EVE account. And they'll run their own fleet by themselves to go mining or to do something, and they're just... It's nothing but menus... and stuff, and this sounds kind of weird, but I still think it's an interesting game and a fun game, but it's like menu simulator, and that's at a certain point.
Yeah,
it's buying a second job.
Like I said, critics of it basically call it buying a second job, which leads me to Crack.com has some amazing stories about stuff that has happened in the video game world.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, some of my favorite stories.
These are amazing stories. One of them, it's one of my favorites that happened in EVE Online. Somebody ended up owning, like, basically being the president of this banking clan in which people would deposit money and get interest and be able to withdraw it back, and he could then loan it. He literally acted like a bank in the game. And one day, he realized that he was essentially paying a subscription to do a job, to basically do a job. So he decided to play it like a game. He closed the bank, took all the money, and there is no penalty for this. The moderators would not stop him.
Are you sure that? Because that happened in EVE.
Yeah, that did happen in EVE. That's what
we're not EVE. No. What you're talking about is the Goon Squad.
No, incident. This wasn't Goon Squad.
No?
Goon Squad does a lot in EVE. But this one was just this one random banker that took all the money, used it to buy the biggest and most powerful ship in the game, put a bounty on himself, and dared people to come attack him.
Wow.
Although, speaking of EVE and Goon Squad, which Goon Squad has a bad reputation as being asshats, supreme asshats, and I personally have a grudge against them, and part of the reason why I quit EVE. They do this thing called Hulkageddon, which a Hulk is the largest mining vessel in the game, and you can get a lot of profits by using it correctly. So I had a pretty advanced mining ship, and anyway, Goon Squad does this thing called Hulkageddon, where they pay people to hunt miners, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And this is in high security area, which where if you attack someone. Police, NPC police will come and own you. And I was sitting in a mining area in a high security area, and somebody jumped in, and they're right at the edge of my range. And as soon as I saw them, like a minute later, three other people jumped in and started heading towards me. I could not get out in time, and they destroyed my biggest ship. Anyway, so Goon Squad doesn't have a great reputation because they do stuff like that, but they had somebody in their group stole all of their money and locked it away. Supposedly.
Yep. Oh, yeah, I know that story. You know they locked it away in these, like, canisters and then logged out and never logged back in again. And the thing is, these canisters cannot be accessed by anyone else. And if you try and blow them up to get access to them, they're gone.
Well, he also stole the entire group's money. And I've heard that, I mean, that sounds really bad that he stole, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars from the clan that they had earned. But the reason I've heard that he did that is because he had a child that was sick and he stole the money to pay for medical bills, which more understandable, but still.
Wait, no, because the money was just locked away in Eve.
I think he locked.
No, he didn't make any money off of it.
Did he just lock it away?
No, he just locked it away.
Huh.
He locked it away and he logged out and never logged back
yeah,
in.
Yeah, never gave anybody the password for it.
Yep.
Yeah, and so one of the stories that I've heard from Eve is, it's just basically there was like a space battle going out, and one of the players found where the person had like one of these large vessels, cut his power, so he was just just couldn't do anything, and some people was like always said like is that true or not, and they're like, well, it's Eve, so I can see that happening, and that's what I loved about like Eve's stories. It's like, a lot of the stories that come out, it's like, is that true? It's like, I can picture it.
But if you think EVE Online is the only story full of, like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
World of Warcraft has some very interesting stories. The Corrupted Blood Plague.
Yeah. Oh my, yes.
This is a story, I love this story just because of the sheer what the fuck kind of idea behind it. There was this boss in WoW that basically caused this plague effect, in which it was essentially a highly contagious, transferable, like, plague, that poison.
And it was a high-level one, too. Pretty high-level, anyway.
So, what they ended up doing is they discovered that they could not only infect their pets and store them, but when they brought their pets back out, their pets would have that plague.
They could also teleport out after they got poisoned back into a town and infect people in the town.
Yep. So basically this group of players decided, and they cut a swath through World of Warcraft, killing hundreds of players. Not in real life, mind you. And the thing is that they resisted every attempt by the developers to put a halt to them.
Yeah.
Like, they'd, like, infect their pets and store them away so they weren't caught in the purges.
Didn't NPCs in the towns also get infected? Yeah,
they'd infect the NPCs so that players going up to them for quests would get infected by this plague.
And that's bad because this once again was kind of a higher level, like, plague. It did a good amount of damage. So low level people would get infected and instantly die.
Yep. And it was so bad. In fact, it is actually studied to this day by real life, like, biologists and, you know, terror prevention groups as a case study.
Because it models the way a real plague
could happen.
Could happen, and, you know, how it would keep coming back and stuff. It's very interesting.
Yes, and I recommend, if you go to cracked.com, that's where we get these.
One other story I remember reading on there is the guy that ran away at people.
Yes, I love that story. Yes!
What was that game? Was it EverQuest, maybe?
It might have been EverQuest. It was EverQuest. And the Bard.
Yes, Fancy Pants the Bard.
No, so, just Fancy.
Was it Fancy? Okay, well, anyway. This character, he had stupid character, wore these like, pink pants, and he was on a no-rules server. So anything goes.
No rules. No. Essentially, yeah. It's basically, there are no rules.
PvP and everything else. So, this guy got a lot of crap for his character because he looked real derpy.
Well, no, because he was a bard. Nobody plays a bard.
True. And the only... So, yeah, he was worse with everybody and every stat except for one. And that was being able to run slightly faster than one of the strongest creatures in the game. So, he got pissed at these people. Went into a cave where all these creatures are, aggroed them, and ran away at people,
and they could not outrun these giants.
Right, and so they would end up fighting them, getting killed, and then they'd chase him, and then he'd just run away, and then the giants would catch up. And it got so bad that, you know, people were screaming at him, you know, faggot, asshole, stop this, you douchebag. And, you know, he wouldn't stop, and finally an admin came in, which there were admins, but once again, it's a no-rule server, so he wasn't violating anything.
The first admin that came in, the first GM, just popped in and kindly reminded Fancy that this was indeed a no-rule server and sat back and watched the show.
Right, but later...
Finally they got one.
Later they did ask him, could you please stop? And that's all he wanted. He said yes, and he stopped. That's all he wanted someone to actually ask him nicely. But yeah, it's a story of the bard that ran away at people.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, man, these are...
And I still remember, this was these stories that you shared were times when we reconnected. And that's why those stories you guys called are really close to me, because, like, this is around when we started hanging out again, and these are, like, the first stories that I've heard. It's like, I've never... And again, it's like, I never heard of this world kind of scenario. And I'm pretty sure I'm not... I wasn't alone now... That our future audience now
hear
about these past stories that hopefully can sell to their future friends and their futures.
There is one more story I want to do just because I just love the joke and the game, the developer's reaction to this.
Please,
I think I know the story.
It was the story of Harry the Crystal.
Yes, it is.
Yep. So, God, I don't remember what the game was. What it is it was a scripted event where basically players had to go in and shatter these crystals to cause an event to appear.
It was a major update, and in order to trigger the update, all of the servers had to complete the main story quest, which was killing this boss.
The boss hadn't spawned it. The boss was part of the next update.
Okay.
Killing this crystal was how to trigger it.
Right.
And and so the thing is that in one of the servers, this one group decided they're not going to destroy the crystal, they're going to defend it. They became the defenders of Harry. Now the thing is, in this game, monsters leveled up just like the players did. And so they would routinely sacrifice themselves by throwing themselves at Harry to level him up and beef him up. Not to mention, they themselves would continuously fight off enemies. Mm-hmm. And so it got to the point where in order to be able to trigger the next update, they, like, the devs didn't just retcon it and say, nope, it happened, you know. No, instead what happened is it turned into first contract to try and convince players to go in and kill it. Then the devs hired, like, some of the highest level players to go in and attack them.
That failed,
and one of them actually turned and became a defender of Harry. Eventually, the devs themselves went in god mode. They lost.
Yeah, it failed. They went to god mode and they failed to kill this thing. It had gotten so powerful.
But no, but here's where it gets really interesting. It resisted command level developer level commands to shut down. The devs at the time were joking that Harry had achieved sentience. And, you know, eventually, finally, they managed to kill it. But because of their dedication to their valiant efforts to defend Harry.
In that server alone, there is a monument to the defenders of Harry.
Yep, there is a monument to them. And yeah, it's an amazing story, and it's just like, and it's funny because the site that I read this story on made the crack. It's like, so just remember, children, if AI ever develops sentience and try and kill us all, it won't be because of a failed military experiment. It'll be because gamers trained it to.
Thank you much. But yeah, I would definitely suggest, if you're wanting a good read, go on crack.com and look up some of these gaming stories. There are some amazing ones. There's probably more since
It's been a couple of years.
It's been several years since we've looked there, so there's probably even more now. But they explain them way better. They go into way more detail than we have.
Yes.
And they're wonderful.
Yeah, they're amazing stories, and they're just the kind of stories where it's just like, damn, I wish.
Yeah, so this has happened to our video game history, to other people's history that we taught, and it's like, well, going through like a lot of nonsense at the beginning. So I say
they're interesting stories.
Yes.
You know, and to be fair, I covered most of my player. I don't honestly can't think of anything else off the top of my head. The only thing you've missed,
I've missed Ace Attorney again.
Yep.
But we are pretty much out of time.
Yes,
so
we are. future Jesse, please remember to talk about Ace Attorney. You know your favorite franchise of all time.
Yep.
If you do, I'll kill him.
So with that, thank you for listening. I'm Jesse.
Joey.
Mike.
And I hope we get to talk in the corner once again.
In the future.
Oh, God.
Stop!